Today is August 9th, 2019. My name is Akil John Alagada.
I'm Christina Lee.
And we are here today with Alice Wen. So to start off, when and where were you born?
I was born in Taiwan in 1958.
Did you grow up where you were born, or did you move around when you were growing up?
I was born in Tainan, which is the south of Taiwan, and I moved to Taipei, which is north of Taiwan, when I was 3 years old.
And who consists of your family?
I have two brothers and two sisters, so I'm the fourth one. I have a younger brothers.
What were your parents' occupations?
My daddy is an engineer, and my mom pretty much do everything she could to, you know, to provide financial support to the family. My mom does everything.
And what kind of values did your parents instill in you and your siblings when you were growing up?
I didn't grow up in a very rich family, although it's not very poor. But, you know, as I said, my mom has to do multiple jobs, you know, because my father was an engineer, worked for a Japanese company. I think it's called Mitsubishi with three diamonds. Mm-hmm. And they move employee around. So even I was raised up in Taipei, I move around the Taipei area quite a lot. So wherever we move to with the company, my mom has to, you know, find a job to raise the family. Yeah.
What were some of the jobs that your mom took on?
Wow, she does everything. I hardly remember. I know she went to some manufacturing job, but then after work, and she has to do some work at home, like weaving the sweaters, making like $5 Taiwan dollars per piece, something like that. She does a lot of work, and I hardly remember. I just know my mom very busy. Yeah, and she changed job quite a lot, you know, moving around with my daddy. Yeah.
What language did your parents speak with you when you were home?
Taiwanese.
Do you remember what you wanted to be when you grew up?
I always want to be a teacher, because at the age, teacher, you know, is everything. It's so powerful, so knowledgeable. And I said, wow, I want to be a teacher when I grow up. But of course, it changed.
Do you have any extremely memorable experiences that you still remember from when you were growing up?
Yeah, I remember when I moved to Taipei, not long, we have a huge flooding in the area we live, which is like a company's, what do you call it? It's not auditorium, but it's a housing. And I was waking up in the middle of the night. My daddy carried me on his shoulder, and my mom has my little brother, and we have to escape to a tall building. And then from the tall building, we see all the animals, pig, chicken, whatever, all the furniture is all flooded with the, you know, rain or water, really. It was scary. And then we were hungry for like 3 days, and finally the company sent a big pile of congee. Basically has nothing in there, just the congee, and we all try to, you know, just everybody eat a little bit to survive, not hungry to death. Oh, so that was the scary part, when you see, you know, how powerful the water can carry away everything. And it was middle of the night, and I guess some people did not, you know, escape from the quick flooding. And we stayed near the river, which is Danjiang River in Taipei, and it was scary. I don't remember, I was maybe 3-5 years old.
What was the community or neighborhood that you grew up in like?
More like a middle-income neighborhood, and you know, both parents all need to work, not only daytime, you know, multiple jobs, because at that time it was like an agricultural era, so it's not fully industrial work environment. Even my daddy was an engineer working industrial. You know, it's like kids, we all need to take care of ourselves, you know, because there's no parent around day and night.
And was your family religious growing up?
No, not really. Maybe my parent was Buddhist, because I saw my mom, you know, on every occasion, and she would do, you know, pray and then have the festival, mm-hmm. some kind of that for the God.
Did you have any other family traditions, whether that be religious or cultural, that you remember practicing?
No, other than the bye-bye, no, not really, yeah. But it's like throughout the year, so many occasions I hardly remember the days. But I know whenever my mom would do that, you know, she would, you know, tell us, oh, get ready for it, yeah.
Did you travel much when you were growing up?
No. I think our first international trip was to U.S. to study abroad. Hmm. Yeah.
When was that?
1983. Hmm. Right. December 1983. I remember it's December because it was Christmas season. And I came like 2 weeks before school starts, so I can get a feel what's the Christmas like in United States, because we saw so much of it on TV or the news media. And I have a college senior. She studied at Salt Lake City, University of Utah. And she knew I'm coming to U.S., so she wrote to me, said, hey, you can come over before school starts, and we can have a Christmas holiday here in Salt Lake City. And that really inspired me, because I never know what Christmas like. It's never snow in Taiwan. And it was white Christmas in Salt Lake City in December. And because it was a quarter system for my college senior, so they only get 2 weeks break. Unlike a semester, so that's what I spent my first vacation in Salt Lake City.
Was your family supportive of you going to study abroad in the United States? Did they have any strong feelings about you going abroad?
Well, first of all, they didn't like it, because I'm the first one in my family, you know, get away from the house or the family, and it's so far away. My mom say, United States is not safe place. There are so many crime going on. You don't want to go there. So initially, they all, you know, disapprove me going abroad. But eventually, I convinced them.
Yeah. What program did you come to study in the United States?
It was meteorology. Yeah, my undergraduate was in atmospheric science or physics, astronomy science. But we studied both the ground, the surface, all the way to space. And I said, you know, when I was little, I wanted to be a teacher, but later on, I decided I want to be an astronaut. I think that's the time the U.S. launched the moon, right? So that was very inspiring. I said, I want to be an astronaut. So I chose that field because I was very good at math and physics, and I'm not a hardworking student. I don't like to study or memorizing things. That's, you heard me. I don't remember exactly, because when I was little, I was tested in talents. I'm very good at logical, mechanic, or that kind of analytical thinking, but I'm very poor at language and memorizing. So I knew that, and I said, well, no matter how hard I study, I'm probably going to forget it right away. So I chose to be, you know, a scientist studying physics and math. So when I applied for the college, I chose those specific fields. But I don't like chemistry. So anything related to chemistry, I don't want it. So I really have a limited field to choose. So I was studying atmospheric science for undergraduate. And that gave me the scholarship to come to United States. That was at University of Oklahoma, Norman. Mm-hmm. They have 5 years, I think, a satellite, some kind of research and study. It has a very good grant, so they can afford to give a scholarship to foreign graduate students. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so what year did you get your undergraduate degree?
It was not until January 1987.
And at that time, were there a lot of women in science?
Not really, mm-hmm. Yeah. I think there are only 2 female in my graduate study. And I just told you about, that was a girl from Korea. And we became good friends because we two were the only 2 foreign graduate students. And we're both very poor in English. But she can write her name in Chinese. She cannot read and write, but she can write it. And so sometimes we have a hard time to communicate because that was our first time we came to the United States. Sometimes we were all writing in Chinese to communicate. That was very interesting. Yeah.
So you did your undergraduate education in Taiwan. Yeah. How was that experience?
Oh, it was difficult and challenging, you know. From high school to college, we all have a nationwide exam. And you have, depends on your score, then you get to choose which high school or which college to go to. For high school, I went to the best high school in Taiwan, and it was in Taipei. It's a Taipei First Girl High. And I was in the science major, so there are only 2 classes in the entire high school has a science major. The rest of them are in business or medical school or everything else. Yeah, and since we were in science and engineering, when we take the college entrance exam, we got to compete with all the guys, because guys, they all choose engineering and scientific kind of major, because that's at that time it's easier to get a job, right? And guys need to get a job in order to have a wife. So we have to compete. So I got not too bad of score, and then I get into the college to study in the field I like. So I was lucky, and it was away from home. Not too far, though. It was still in the northern part of Taiwan. But at the time, you always want to get away from home, right? So we all choose the colleges far away from home.
Taipei First Girls High, was that an all-girls high school?
Yeah, it's all girls.
How did you like that?
Good or bad, you know, I didn't really have a strong feeling, because at that time, when you get into the high school, that means you have to study hard to get to the college. So that was just a stepping stone. And we have a very strict uniform. The hair need to be in the middle of the ear part. That show, it really look very stupid. And straight, and then middle of the ear, and the skirt has to be like that long, so you look like a nun, you know? You're not attractive to anything at all, so So they just want you, okay, study, okay? So even sometimes we have to take the same bus with the best high school. It's a men's high school. And we have to ride a bus together. But we're not allowed to, like, not really, nobody, no teacher in the bus. But it's like very strict. So if somebody claims, say, you wrote letter to a boy in a male school, you will be in trouble. You will be called up to the principal office and to be interviewed. So we just know to study. But, you know, remember the water, the flooding experience, kind of scary in my mind. So I did not know how to swim, and I did not want to get into water, you know. But in my high school, it's required to swim 25 feet from this end to that end. Whichever way you want to do, you have to swim from that end to that end. It's like 25 feet. To me, it's like very long, you know. And I did not know how to swim. I'm afraid of water. I don't want to put my head above water. So I have to take, during the summer break, take the swimming lesson to learn that. I did not raise my head. I still put my head under the water, but I'm managing to swim from that end to that end. That was a good experience.
What did you do outside of academics, either in high school or in college?
In high school, I studied, and I took some classes after work to learn how to cook and sewing, and then do the floral arrangement and photography. That was my interest. Yeah, since I cannot sing and I cannot dance.
And was that something that, like, a lot of your friends did, or is that something that you just really wanted to do? And so
I really wanted to do, mm-hmm. Yeah. I didn't have, like, the best friend in high school, you know, because everybody was study individually and very hard, and we sort of competing each other too, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't have, like, you know, best friend from high school.
So did you, overall, do you think that your experience in school in Taiwan is really different from your experience in school in the States?
Oh, yes. I came to United States, and I didn't really need to study hard, because everything I need to learn, I pretty much all learn it, you know, in college. You know, I don't want to say in high school, because we really didn't learn that much. Well, we learn a lot, but mainly for the college entrance exam. That's the challenge part. If you don't get to the college, you don't have a career, you don't have a job, you don't have a life, basically. But, you know, but in college, you know, I learned a lot, and came here, I basically learned everything I know, but in English. So that was the challenge part, you know. I know the question, and I know the answer, but how to write it in English, that was my major challenge.
Did you always want to move to the United States when you were growing up?
Not really. The reason I came here, after I graduated from college, I took some job interview, and some of the institutes or companies, they only hire one people, and not only you have to take an academic exam, they also tested in the IQ, and I was lucky, you know. For several companies, they interviewed me, I was selected, you know, as the first choice. But if I took the job, and that means all my college, you know, college mates, they won't have a job, right? Because in that field, there's a limited job. So, but I took the first one. I only work 1 month, and I quit. So my mom was very mad at me, because that was a very easy job, and that was the reason I quit. Because graduate from college, you study so hard, you have a dream, you want to apply your knowledge and skill, and you want to be able to contribute to the country or the society. And then the job I took was the meteorology center in Air Force. So every morning there's a commuter bus come to your home, come to your house, pick you up, and then take you to work. And then my job only took me 1 hour to finish. And the rest of the day, I just play ping pong with the colleague. And sometimes I take a long hour's lunch break, watch a movie, shopping around, because in the area there's a lot of store. So I didn't feel challenged, you know. Just sit there. The rest of the work hours, sit there and chat with your boss, and that really wasn't what I expected. The pay was really high and really good. That's why they only hire one. So, and at the time I wrote to my college senior, and then she encouraged me, said, "Why don't you come study abroad?" And after that, I decided, hey, there might be something challenging for me to do. And otherwise, you know, now I have an easy job, a nice pay, and I didn't need to spend anything on the transportation or uniform because they gave us uniform too. So, and then they provide lunch and then everything at the company, right? That really is really nice job to have. And people work there, they are like after college, and they're doing the military services. That's a requirement, 2 years. So they all just came to the office and chat with you, you know. So I decided, and my mom, because that my mom got get into some kind of how do you call it? Like private loan. Like if your family needs money, and then we will get some like 30 people, and every month we contribute like $10,000 to you. So you have a big chunk of money and to pay for tuition or loan, and then that person or the loaner need to pay back every month. So my mom got into that program, right? Because all my salary, I mean, I don't need to spend much, right, other than my own outfit, right, after work. And then just 1 month, I quit. So, and then I went back to school, my college, to be a research associate, and then to study on TOEFL and the GRE to prepare to take those exams so I can apply for college here.
But when you were in Taiwan, did you study English to get ready to come to the States?
Not until I tried to study for the TOEFL. Mm-hmm. And yeah, and even some of the textbooks we use, they are all English. We can read better than writing, but speaking is like, when I came to United States, my graduate advisor call me Miss Huan, because my maiden name is Huang, H-U-A-N-G. And American, they all separate the vowel, right? So he always call me Miss Huan. I have no idea, you know, he was calling me, because we say Huang together, U and A, but I say Huan, H-U-A-N-G. So when I studied for TOEFL, I actually took a few times to pass that. And that was one of the major reasons delay came to U.S. because I cannot pass TOEFL at the first time. So I came here in spring semester rather than most of people that came here in fall. And that's because I did not pass to get accepted for 4 semesters. I came 1 semester later.
Was it difficult to obtain a visa to come to the United States?
If you have the scholarship and you get the offer letter, no. No, not as a graduate student, yeah.
And what was your biggest challenge coming to America? Was it the language? Was it being homesick? Was there anything else that really challenged you when you moved here?
Yeah, it's all everything about language, you know, and the cultural difference, and of course, homesick that you cannot help, mm-hmm. right? But language part and the cultural differences, the way we do things in the United States is very different from, you know, what we do in Taiwan. Yeah, Taiwan is more family-oriented, mm-hmm. and people help each other, but in the United States, you are more independent. You have to do everything, and you have to learn and how to do it. Like, I never know how to use a screwdriver, and you know, here you got to figure out what's flat, what's cross. Because I still remember one of my job, my boss asking me, "Can you give me a flat?" I said, "What's flat?" Oh, I was like, "Give me a 16-pin female, 9-pin male, something like that." I said, "What are you talking about?" You know, it's the adapter. Mm-hmm. At that time, the adapter has a 16 male or female, one way or the other. I said, "I have no idea what you're talking about." That's what I said, language, you know, because we all call it differently. Yeah, and then since I never really guess hands-on work on any hardware part, and yeah, again, language took me a while to learn. Remember, I said my worst talent is memorizing and language.
What was your first impression of the United States, and how did it compare to the expectations that you had maybe before you got here?
My first impression, this is a big country, because Taiwan is small, and then came here, and then it's so diversified, you know, culture, people from all over different places, and to learn your background so we can communicate and get to know each other better, so we won't offend each other, you know. That was the biggest challenge and impression. But when I first came to United States, I was in Salt Lake City. People are very nice, even in supermarket. You know, we spoke in Chinese. People they answer you in Chinese because I think in Salt Lake City, a lot of Mormon, and they go all over the world, and some of them, they know Chinese, so that was interesting part. What was the other question?
First impression and how it compared to the expectations that you had before you came.
Okay. I really did not have much expectation other than I want to come here to learn more and to be an astronaut. And everything else we learn, you know, is more bad things than good things. You know how the TV, they all report some bad things, they don't report good things. But there are lots of great things I learned before I came to U.S. And I really like it, really like it. But my mom worry about me every day, you know. They want to make sure I still live and survive. Because I think United States is dangerous place. We, in Taiwan, we really don't need to worry about safety or crime. It's not the kind of crime will kill you alive. That's what I meant, yeah.
That impression that you had when you first came to America, did that change over time as you lived here for longer and longer? Like the impression of it being really big or really diversified, the people being really nice. Did that change at all the longer you stayed here?
No, not really. Yeah. It's still a very interesting place, you know, for life journey. Because every day you meet different people and you learn different things. And the one major difference here is more me. But back in Taiwan, in the culture, I grew up, it's more family. It's all us. But here it's more focused on yourself, and it took me a long while, many years to learn how to, you know, think for myself, do things for myself, rather than think for others.
So you came to the States because you wanted to be an astronaut, and then you eventually ended up working for NASA.
Yeah!
So how did that happen?
Oh, that's after I got my first master degree is in meteorology. And at the time I graduated, it's about the same time my husband finished his PhD degree in Salt Lake City. Oh, I missed that part. Oh, remember I came to U.S. to have 2 weeks vacation, and I guess it was the fate, because my college senior, she has a boyfriend. It was her and her boyfriend plan on picking me up at the airport, but for whatever reason, her boyfriend's car just broke down and could not make it. So she asked one of her friends and to come to the airport, pick me up. And I guess from the time pick it up and until I left, we became good friends. And that was my future husband afterwards. So So that's how I met my husband in Salt Lake City. But remember, I studied in Norman. Mm-hmm. So after 2 weeks, I have to go to school. But then after every quarter, he has a quarter system. I have a semester system. So we have to find the common break. And then we'll visit each other, right? And when I graduated in January, in March, he got a postdoctoral job in Pittsburgh. So we moved together to Pittsburgh. I also missed the other part. We married when we both still in graduate school. And the reason is funny. The reason he married me is because he was broke. Because we were apart, right? And he was a graduate student. I was a graduate student. We both didn't have much money. We came to United States probably with $1,500 in the pocket, right? But every month we have a scholarship. That's enough for tuition and a meal and dorm, no problem. And we have savings to buy a car and vacation. But while I mentioned that part, he broke because we have to find a common break to tour around the United States. We both like natural resources, so we often took a break to visit national park. I think that's the period I visit most of the national parks in the United States. And he had to spend all his scholarship not only on tuition and living and also on vacation and the phone call at a time. That's a long distance call charge, if you remember, unlike now. I mean, even worldwide call is free, but at a time, international call is like $1 per minute. Mm-hmm. And that's a long distance call charge. So he broke. He said, well, let's get married. So we married in 2 years later, even we both still in school. So when he graduated from his PhD, I got my master. I couldn't continue the PhD program because he got a job in postdoctoral job in Pittsburgh. So we moved there. And I said, well, since there's no meteorology or NASA or anything like that in Pittsburgh, so I started to look for a job. And lucky, I got a job in Greenbelt, Maryland. But I got pregnant. And I was really sick, you know. And so I wrote a letter to the employer in NASA, say, you know, well, since married, this is the first time we really live together, you know. And then I'm pregnant. I didn't feel like, you know, I can perform the job at the best that I could. Can you put my offer on hold till I deliver the baby? And they were nice enough to say yes. So I put the job offer on hold for a year after, you know, I had a label. Then I took the job at NASA. But it didn't work long.
Yeah, so your job was in Maryland.
Yeah.
But before you were living in Pittsburgh because of your husband. So did your husband have to move to Maryland with you?
Okay. He continued his PhD research and then living in Maryland. So he had to commute like a 4 or 5 hours driving every week now, not on a daily basis. Yeah, because we still have somebody need to, you know, provide the financial support to the family. Mm-hmm. And at the time, we had a newborn baby. So I took a job at NASA, and then he just commute every week to see me and my son. But good thing my pay with NASA was very nice. Maybe 30% higher than my husband's postdoctor. But I didn't work there long, only 1 year. Because he got a job at Exxon. And that's a real industrial job, and the pay was like more than double, right, than postdoctoral research job. So I had to quit my job and then move with him to Baton Rouge, Louisiana. At the time, I was like, where's Baton Rouge? Actually, when you ask me what's the huge difference, living in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, is not like living in the United States. You know what I mean? Because there, Baton Rouge, there are more French descent, more Cajun people. And I already have a challenge in English, right? They speak a different English. And they don't understand my English. And I think people living in Louisiana, they are like a closer family. They all want to live in Louisiana. They don't want to move outside Louisiana. Even I was in Baton Rouge, that's the capital. And then Louisiana is the biggest tourist city. But people like, if there's a traffic stop on highway, everybody stop to look. What happened? Because that might be my relatives, my friends' relatives, because everybody know each other. And because they live so close together, they don't go outside. So to me, I was like the animal in the zoo. Everywhere I go, people stare at me with thousands of eyes. I said, you know, who is that species, where she came from, you know, like, I mean, it's not like unfriendly, but it's they don't see people like me, you know, in Louisiana. And when I communicate with my technician or other people a job, it was challenged. They got a like, Cajun accent, and I got this Chinese accent. Sometimes it will become jokes.
So where else have you lived before coming to Houston? You said there was Oklahoma, there was a brief stint at Salt Lake City. Norman, Oklahoma.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh, Maryland, mm-hmm. Baton Rouge.
And then Louisiana, and then Houston.
And then Houston.
So Houston is my second home because I have lived here 20 years. And remember, I only lived in Taiwan for 20 plus years, 21, 22 years. So this is my second home. So this is the longest city I stay in the United States. But my husband and me, we managed to visit maybe more than 40 states in the United States. Mm-hmm. We try to take every break, vacation, go around the United States. So that's why I said this is a big country. I still haven't see every part of United States, but we went to, you know, the major part of the cities we like to see.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you talked about your experience feeling like you were being kind of looked at differently in Louisiana.
Mm-hmm.
Were there any other moments, like any other places that you felt kind of different because you were Asian, or were there, in contrast, some cities that you felt like, hey, there's like also a lot of Asian people here, or maybe people aren't looking at me differently?
The other city were okay, like Salt Lake City, mm-hmm. because those people that live there has a strong religion and then went to different part of world. So, I mean, they were very nice and friendly to us. Even we spoke, you know, broken English, but they understood us. And there are lots of very nice senior ladies. They are really nice to us. And Norman is more small town, but it's a college town, and it's a lots of international students. So I wasn't looking at that way either. And then in NASA or Pittsburgh is also college town, college city, right? So I didn't feel like I was discriminated that part. And in NASA, it was a scientist, so we all focus on scientific research, that kind. It's less cultural impact. But move to Louisiana, that was the time I felt I'm a foreign. I'm really a foreign. Like, I don't fit in. It took me a while to adjust. Yeah, to adjust. By that time, I already live in the United States. How long? I moved to Louisiana in 1990, so it was how many? 7 years already. 7 years.
How did you adjust? Was your husband kind of helpful in feeling like you weren't so alone?
Not really. We both learned to adjust. Yeah, and we all just try to. Work hard and study hard to support the family. See, remember, I work at NASA. I got nice pay. When I moved to Louisiana, I got a 30% pay cut because I work at Louisiana State University, and I took the job. It was a research associate. And Louisiana living expense is not as high as, you know, Maryland. And plus, it's a university job, right? But good thing is, since I work on campus, I took advantage to study on my second master degree, computer science. So I work full time and I study part time in the evening, and I have a little baby at home. So we didn't really have much time to. For social life, because, you know, day and night I have a different job, and then I hardly have time to sleep, to be honest, because I didn't have a computer science degree, remember, for my undergraduate, and my graduate study was in computer science. But at that time, the computer science is like the biggest job market, right? And then yeah, thinking I always need to move around with my husband. That's the time I was thinking, because see, I move from here and to Maryland and to here. So studying computer science might give me a better job opportunity to move with him. So, but I was put on conditional probation admission, because I never took any computer language. Other than the Fortran language, I took in my college back in Taiwan. So they said, you don't have any computer language skill. And how can you study in computer science? Every single course requires you to learn at least two languages in order to be able to do the homework. So, and I don't have time to take those computer language courses. I have to take a real course, like a database, then I have to learn the computer language. I take AI, artificial intelligence, I have to learn this, the prologue or whatever, you know. So I have to study on the side, besides taking the class and then study the language, so to be able to do the homework and pass the exam. So they put me on conditional admission, but good things, I made it straight A through the graduate study and got my degree. And we both all try to work hard. And when I work daytime and nighttime study, my husband, after work, I need to take care of the baby, right? And then when I graduate, then he went back to MBA program. So he worked full-time. He didn't take an executive for MBA. Even they offer him, LSU offer him executive for MBA because he work at Exxon, right? And Exxon give a huge grant to college or LSU. But he want to really learn it. So he took the hard way. It means that he got to study like 4 years part-time. So we took a time to work and study second degree, you know, and we cannot take a term. So we didn't have much time for social life other than work and study and the family, yeah. But it pays off. I got a nice job after I finished my master's degree in computer science. I took an industrial job and I got a double pay, so that's why he can go back to school to study for his MBA. Yeah, he didn't really need it, but he said, you know, just doing the research all his life, he wanna you know, make a difference too. Yeah.
So what brought you to Houston after Baton Rouge?
Good question. That was for my son. Remember, we're living. Louisiana has been like a second to the bottom in education other than Mississippi, right? Even my son was tested, you know, to be gifted and talented when he was 3 years old. I took him to doctor and he got tested as gifted and talented. So he was able to take gifted and talented class from preschool and kindergarten all the way to elementary. But Louisiana education environment is very poor. So poor, I mean, not just the teacher resources. Even we were good because he was in a very small class, like 7 students only. But it's a mixed school. Means if they have gifted and talent program, you gotta have students from other area. They are very poor. And so even you are very concentrated in your class, you don't mix with other people, but still kids, they observe and learn, right? So even the bathroom, they don't have a door or something, don't have a tissue paper. So we were thinking, you know, after he finished the 5th grade, we got to move. So we both decided we're going to move to a better education place. And Houston is the closest one to Baton Rouge and is a big city, has a better education environment. So we decided to, you know, throw the resume and see if we can find a job in Houston. And I was in computer science, right? And so it was easy, you know. I just applied for the job, and I got an offer at Exxon, Shell Oil, and Chevron, and Deloitte and Touche consulting firm, or even Compaq. At that time, there was still a company called Compaq. I got several offers, but husband, he did not get any offers because he was in PhD, right? And then the pay at Exxon is already pretty high, and I guess master and in computer science, I had the advantage, but we couldn't we did not delay the children's education. So my husband convinced me to take my son and then move to Houston first so he can get to the junior high because that's a transition, right? Even we were thinking about it during his elementary school, but as I say, he was in a very concentrated program and he always studied one or two grades above his level. So he was doing good, but we still want to look for better education environment. So I took my son to Houston, and my husband did not want me to work for his competitor, like Chevron or Shell Oil. So I took the job at Exxon, and we moved here. So that was like 20 years from today, we moved here in August 1999. So, and I start to look for housing so I can put him in a school district. It's has a nice learning environment. Mm-hmm. And I work at Exxon Chemical, which is at the Energy Corridor, Memorial and Eldridge. Mm-hmm. And I found a house. It's called Lex Parkway. It's right behind it, you know, just a few miles. And that was very nice living environment. But I told my husband, we don't need to do house hunting. I'm just going to, you know, live there. And it's a gated environment. So it's safe for me and my son to stay there alone. But after we went back to Baton Rouge, he came with me for the job interview. And then he started, oh no, the school district there isn't very good unless we want to go to private school. And I said, that's a long way to go to finish the 12th grade, right? And school here in Houston, tuition is much higher, I mean, private school than the school in Baton Rouge because everything is cheaper in Louisiana. So we decided to look for the same builder, but you know, better school district, and that's why I found a house in Katy. At that time, the builder Kikarillo just start to build housing in the community, and that's why we moved there.
So what high school did your son go to?
He went to the new high school called Single Ranch High.
That's where he graduated.
That's where you graduated? Yeah, really? You live in Katy?
Yeah.
So it was so close. Yeah. See, actually, he's supposed to go to Taylor High from where we live. But I guess in our subdivision, somebody has influence to the superintendent or I don't know what's the impact. So they divide the subdivision, make us go to the new high school, Single Ranch. So actually, Taylor is very close to us, but we have to go far to Single Ranch High. But that school is new, has good computer facility, learning environment. So we were pleased, yeah. So we have lived in Katy ever since.
What is your son's name?
Nicholas Wen.
And where did he end up in, like, for college?
Oh, he went to business school in Austin, University of Utah in Austin. Mm-hmm. He went to the MPA, Master of Professional Accountant. Mm-hmm. Must be accounting. Yeah, he took a 5 years program, and so he got a MPA degree, and he kind of goofed around, mm-hmm. you know, because remember, he was studying one or two grades above the level, so when he came here, and he took two grades above, like math, and when he walked to the classroom, you know, all the other think, hey, stupid kids, you walk into the wrong classroom. You know, boys grow slower than girls, right? So when he was elementary, he wasn't very high, and then just moved to a new city, a big city, and then the first class, and he walked into the eighth grade math. People were thinking, hey, you are in the wrong classroom. But anyway, he's supposed to be able to finish high school in 3 years, but he didn't want to go to college before all his friends. He make really good friends at high school. Even now, they're still good friends. So he waited at the same time, graduated with all his high school students. And he went to MPA program. He's supposed to finish that program in 4 years. Because I think at the third year, they got an internship, right, at the Big Four accounting firm. And immediately after internship, they already give you an offer, even you're not graduate. Mm-hmm. So he already have a job offer. So on the last year, he didn't want to graduate earlier either. He wanted to graduate all with his friend. So he will all go fishing. But it's okay. Yeah.
But you've also been involved with business as a consultant.
Yeah.
So when did that happen between you working at Exxon to consulting?
Right. Remember, I came here earlier And I try to help my husband mm-hmm. to get transfer to Exxon in Houston, because he work at Exxon refinery in Baton Rouge. That's downstream, and he was doing R&D. But here, the downstream is in Baton, which is not a good living environment or mm-hmm. education environment. So we try to get to different area. And Exxon is so big, but it's not very easy. But he was lucky enough, got transfer. I guess because I work for Exxon too, and you know, that might be the part of the reason he was able to transfer here. But after he got transferred to Houston, we both work at Exxon, and we all have a nice pay, the same benefits. Like we have a gasoline car for the Exxon gas station, you get a 10% off. Even one people work at Exxon, the entire family all get a gasoline discount car, right? And you know, you have medical, I have medical, we don't have to have two medical, you know. A lot of benefits are duplicate. So I was thinking, hey, I came here and at that time, Exxon just acquired mobile, like two big oil company merged together. And one is using Apple, one is using Windows, you know, for example, like Apple and Orange. Completely different mm-hmm. System. You know, from desktop, email system, all the way to enterprise, totally different. So we have a huge integration work to do. And I was put in the SAP system implementation project for the global, not only in North America, but, you know, Middle East, Europe, and Asia Pacific, you know, or Africa. I was put in that program. Part of the reason, remember, I had an industrial job in Louisiana, and my company got acquired by another company, and they did the global implementation doing using the SAP applications. And because they have so many subsidiaries and all in different industry, so they have to use some kind of enterprise system. And I had that experience. And that might be part of the reason Exxon hired me, because at the time, Exxon Mobil, or at the time was Exxon only, and then Shell Oil or Chevron, they all tried to get into the enterprise system. So soon after I hired, then I was put into the program. At that time, consulting pay is double than employee pay. And, you know, so I said, hey, you know, we both work on the same company. You know, we really did not have a double benefits. So after I finished the SAP global project, it was like a 5 years program. And after I finished that, then I quit. Now I formed my own consulting firm. Now I start to work for BP and other oil company as a contractor or as a project manager or architect, mainly on the enterprise architecture or data architecture. So that's the time I quit and then run my own business. I thought, you know, I only need to work, you know, less than 6 months. I have the same pay, yeah.
And that's iWen International.
Yeah, that's iWen International. But that job require me to travel a lot because it depends on client, mm-hmm. where the client is. So 1 year I had to go to Baton Rouge, or actually Louisiana, you know, because Shell Oil has a big presence in Louisiana, right, in New Orleans. So I have to commute there every week, like, you know, come home on Friday afternoon and leave on Sunday afternoon on a weekly basis, because I was doing consulting job, yeah.
Did you face any serious barriers throughout your career?
Throughout the career? Exxon Mobil doing the global system implementation, that was my the challenging part in my career development, because it was such a diversified work environment. People from Europe, they think their system is the best, and they know better about the application of the system than anyone in America. Any American in United States. Remember, it's a global project, and everybody all want to use their system, you know. And so is Singapore. They think, I have the SAP 4.0. That's the newest, the greatest issue, or adopt my system. But in Europe, they have 2.0. I mean, that's like a dinosaur, right? And then São Paulo Chemical, they have 3.0. So and I was project manager. That means every day from 8 to 5, I was running meeting, to get everybody buying. That was really difficult. Prior to that, I'm very strong on my left brain. I'm never strong on my right brain. So deal with people and try to get everybody buying on one decision. That was like meeting after meeting after meeting and after meeting. Mm-hmm. And then not to mention, even we're supposed to work 8 to 5, but talking to Europe, you got to do early morning meeting, talk to Asia Pacific, you got to work at 9. So dealing with different people, really tough, particularly European.
Do you think being a woman and a minority, do you think that put any significant barriers in your way during your career?
Yes, that was also during SAP implementation. I never thought, I'm a woman and minority, but in that project, somehow, I feel like I was very discriminated, because I'm a woman and I'm foreign. They don't hear what I say, or what I say made no difference. But I have to gain everybody's buy-in so we can move forward without a decision, without a consensus on every part. You can move, but we can drag the project, too long because there's a limited budget. And even the Exxon Mobil, such a big company, and they always say, diversify, right? But now when I work in the SAP global implementation, other than that, I never thought that I'm a female employee. Yeah.
So you've talked a little bit about the challenging parts of your career. What are some parts that you really enjoyed?
I guess the first industrial job, mm-hmm. after my master's degree in computer science, mm-hmm. I was the only computer science degree work at the company in the IT department. So I was given opportunity to do everything and anything, because they think, wow, I'm the guru, mm-hmm. Even I was hired as a system administrator, mm-hmm. but I was given opportunity and empowered to do everything, I want to do. So I went from system administrator to doing the database management, doing application programming, and doing the network system, local area network, wider area network. I didn't really have that much background in networking at all. Everything is all on the job learning. I even need to take a screwdriver and fix PC. How in the world? I know what's the cross and fed. But they all think, I have the computer science degree. I'm the master. So from desktop, hardware, software, application, and integration, desktop with the enterprise system integration, I would say, hey, can you do that? So I learned a lot. A lot, a lot, and a lot. And That was the part I really enjoyed. I think I gained most experience on that job. I grew myself, you know, really well. That's why I guess my resume looked really nice, because I have experience on, you know, from growing up. And then I didn't go to the manager right away, right? I went from system administrator. And after 3 years, you know, they see how I perform, and I was promoted to be the IT manager. And then later on has the company acquisition. So I was doing a lot of networking, system integration, and SAP system implementation. So I learned a lot right after my master's degree. And I think that's the glory of my life. Working at Exxon, really nice pay, and then learn a lot, but mainly on the soft side. That means, you know, dealing with human relations, and that's never my interest, because I like to learn and I like challenge, but I don't want to deal with so many people issues. But working at a system, global system, because everybody. When I say everybody, you know, Exxon has a chemical, has, you know, downstream, has an upstream, and then Europe has a different company system. Just agree on the company core. That pie, it took forever. That part I didn't enjoy that much, because it's just way too many issues. Trying to marry apple with orange together. It's men, like a man and woman's war, if you try to fight.
You are currently a member of several community organizations.
Yeah.
Can you describe what you do in those roles?
Okay, I get into the community services. It's when my high school, as Taipei First Girls High, when it celebrated 100 years old birthday, and that's the first time I went to the Chinese community. Prior to that, you know, I focus a lot on work, and then, you know, the work life is already very busy. Really didn't have much social life or the community services other than science and Boston, and that's with the ExxonMobil program. I volunteered to be science ambassador, so we can give grant to school and then help them on the science and math program. But I still come up with the company, right? And that didn't take too much of my time. But when my high school celebrated 100 years old, then I realized, wow, there are so many Chinese in Houston. And so they start to, to encourage me to go to different social activity events, you know, hosted or organized by my high school. And so later on, they asked me to be the board member, and I went to the board member. Soon I become the vice president and the president. And during my presidencies of my high school, Girls High, I make a few milestones for my alumni association. Last to establish the honor guard, the color guard, you know, Taipei First Girl High, the marching band and honor guard and color guard is world famous. They perform worldwide many years. This year is the 55 years anniversary of that team. And I established that team in Houston because we have lots of activities, international festivals, or National Day, or requires, you know, some kind of colorful team to have an opening ceremony, because we celebrate National Day every year. And since Taipei First Girl High, that team is world famous, and I was the president. And they say, hey, why don't you form a team? And I ask the former president, and they say, You think that's easy? If that's easy, you won't be waiting until you are the president to do that. But remember, I'm the one. I'm not afraid of challenge. Even, you know, came to United States knowing nobody, right? I have no family, no relatives other than the college senior in Salt Lake City. So I was brave enough to accept the challenge to come to United States. So I'm not afraid of challenge. So I formed a team. And so after I established a team for the community and all the international events, formal opening ceremony, including the Independence Day, July 4th, you know, like a care opening ceremony, they all asked us to do. So I became the celebrity of the Chinese community. So other organization, you know, invited me to join their organization. That's why I started to get into the community services. It all started with the Taipei First Girl High Alumni Association. And because that's the best high school, everybody is aware, right? And so remember, we got to take an entrance exam, even going to the high school. So people already respect you because they know you compete at the national level and you are one of the best students. So whatever you do, they have high confidence on you. And I always have a good confidence on myself already. So for, you know, from all the community services demonstration, started to have more organization invite me to join their board. And that's when I became, you know, the treasurer of the Global Federation of Chinese Businesswomen, and later on the vice president and the president, and now the board advisor. And also the Chinese Trader Alumni Association. Yeah, I was board member and then vice president. I'm the president now. And this year, 57 civil organizations elect me to be the chair for the Houston Double 10 National Day Celebration Committee. And that's like huge event, you know, the biggest event in Houston, right? From overseas community affairs council or from Taipei Economic and Cultural Office perspective, because even I say biggest event, but it's not one event. Prior to me, I don't know how many, maybe 10 or 20, but this year I have 30 events just for the National Day celebration. And the events, you know, has variety, you know, golf tournament, tennis tournament, cultural performance at the Stafford Center, or the arts exhibition, all kinds of oil painting, or the, you know, photography, or even ceramic arts, you know, different culture. It's very variety, and I really enjoy this kind of community services because I love people and I enjoy being loved. And when you contribute, people love you and I feel, you know, feel rewarded. You know, that's, to me, that's better than financial incentive. So I started to devote more and more. So now I'm almost not working for my own company. You know, because remember I was doing consulting work, and depends on you want to accept the project or not. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if the project you like, then you take it. If you don't like it, you don't take. So now I devote more time in community services. And I'm a family-oriented person. Remember you asked me what's the challenge? Just say me. It took me maybe more than 20 years to learn that. So now back in the community that has more Chinese or Taiwanese people, they came from the same background and culture like me, I feel like I have a bigger family because my family is still in Taiwan, right? I'm still the only one in United States other than my own family, my husband and my son. So now I feel like I have a bigger family, and I have a lots of good sisterhood and friends, and then so they cannot enlarge my social life, my social network. So I cannot enjoy that part. Before that, I work for my family. Now I cannot work for the community, you know, without pay.
How would you describe the Asian American community in Houston, the one that you've gotten so involved in?
I really enjoy it. I think they make a huge difference, even in United States. Because, like, for example, Chinatown, people, see, we earn from other place, but we contribute to that society, right? Or to that community, I should say. See, we spend a lot of our earning in that. And then they help the business in Chinatown. And then they feed back to, you know, other part of business in the same Asian community. I think for most of Asian people, we help Asian people a lot. That's why we donate here and there and there and there. It's not like I'm a millionaire. But, you know, if I have $1 million, I can have a steak. But if I don't, I have a beef noodle. I also enjoy it a lot. I don't have to eat steak every day. I can have a beef noodle, which only costs $6-7, right, versus $70. So, but then we like to contribute, you know, not only time and then financial-wise, all the support we can give. I think I speak for most of the Asian, am I right? So, and that's why the Asian community grow, you know, in prosperity, because we all have the same kind of thinking. We like, you know, our family, and not only my own family, my bigger family, and my bigger family, and my biggest community. And if you need it, like, remember when I got my first job, see, people help each other without knowing credit, right? There's no credit score or loan you can get easily from bank, right? So, you know, you borrow money from me, I borrow money from them, you know, and return whenever we could, hopefully on a monthly basis. Mm-hmm. People live with their trust. Mm-hmm. One day you will return to me. It might delay 1 month or 3 months, but, you know, we help each other because, you know, the money got a rule, right? Mm-hmm. Sometimes you can afford it, and at the time I might not be able to afford it. I think that's what's growing in the Asian community. We always help each other, and they pass on to generations. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm very proud of, the community services, you know. Yeah, because we help each other. Today, I help you. One day, you don't return to me, but you might return to my kids, my grandkids. You never know, because we're not doing that for that flavor, but just pass on to generations. And hopefully our generation can have a better living environment, and they can have a better life than us. We always ask for better and better and better.
Yeah, you answered a lot of the questions.
Oh, really? Yeah, oh, you ask a good questions.
But something I want to know is, do you identify as an Asian American or a Taiwanese American or, like, completely American? What does that mean to you? What does your identity mean to you?
I think I'm most of the time I'm identified as Asian American. Mm-hmm. And then before China opened the door, we always say we are Chinese. Mm-hmm. But when China opened the door, they say they are the Chinese. And even we are all Chinese, you know, like other part of Chinese descent in Asia, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, or other part of Asia, they are Chinese descent. But being close for almost 50 years in China, we really have a different culture. and different philosophy, different life standard, really very different. And that's why we started to differentiate that we are Taiwanese. Because people from Taiwan, we are more loving and caring, I mean, relatively speaking, okay? It's not everybody from China is all like that, or everybody from Taiwan, but relatively speaking, and for majority part, you know, we try to differentiate that we are Taiwanese, you know. Sometimes it's because political issue, which, you know, I try to stay away. But from cultural perspective, we really have a different thinking, mindset, and philosophy. You know, we have different moral standards, and that's why we started to differentiate, hey, we are Taiwanese, hey, we are Taiwanese, we are Taiwanese. Because Taiwanese people from Chinese people from Taiwan who came to the United States much earlier, at least 50 years earlier than people from mainland of China. And most of the Asian American established in the United States, they are all from Taiwan. A majority of them are from Taiwan. But because we are called, we are Chinese, right? Yeah, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so,
I do.
Yeah, but now people, when we talk and the way we do, the people from mainland, we know, oh, you are from Taiwan. Like, sometimes we not open up your mouth, they already know you are Taiwan, because only Taiwan people would do things like that. They think it's stupid, but, you know, I don't think it's stupid, you know. If the more I give, you know, the better community gonna be. You know, I don't have to do everything just for myself. Yeah, and that's remember the big part of difference between U.S. and Taiwan. In United States, it's more individual basis. People are more focused on. Me, and we are all more think of a bigger family. So it took me a while to learn, hey, I can do something for myself. I don't have to feel guilty, you know. Yeah. And that impact, like my generation, like my son, he doesn't have that because he was born here, he grew up here, so he think that's a natural thing to do, right? But to us, it's a big shift, the mind thinking. Hey, I can have a spa. I would not feel guilty. I didn't go home to cook for my family. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. Because we cannot used to give. Mm-hmm. We used to give, and that's how the Asian community grow very well. Yeah, I really enjoy it, and then. Yeah, and I want to be part of it and then continue to contribute as much as I can. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I have one more question.
Yeah, I think in the interest of time.
Okay. What advice would you give to a future generation of immigrants or Asian Americans?
I think a love, you know, give more love to people. If you show your love, people hardly can hate you, right? You love them, you know, one way or later, they're gonna come back to love you because they see the power of it. If you empower people, you love them, you support them, you empower them, and they will become a better one. One day, they're gonna come back and then to help other people that can help, you know, not necessarily you, but we want to pass on to generations. So I want to give the message to my son. And then he has been doing sort of community services because I encourage him to took Amigo International when he was in high school first year. After first year, he took a Spanish language, and then he went to Honduras for 2 months. Honduras is the country without, you know, the drinking water, You know, you cannot drink from tap water. You have to go through the filter, and there's no power after sunset. But he went there and need to help people build a water well or the school. And he learned a lot because he saw his host family has only 2 rooms and have 4 kids. And at the summer, 2 months, you know, he stayed a very good family already, but they have only 2 bedrooms. And they gave 1 bedroom to my son and the other boy volunteer. And they all squeezed together 1 room. So, I mean, work there is very hardworking because all the sanitizing things are not very well. So the other boy, they only have 2 students for one town. And the student got sick and then was in hospital for a while and then sent back to United States. So he was the only one, did all the township work. But it was worth it because he came back. Before he came back, after 2 months, community services, they killed two chicken. And to feed all the people, the entire town people, including the volunteer from surrounding town, only 2 chicken. And he didn't want to take any bites of those chicken because he saw his host family. I asked him, what do you eat, breakfast, lunch, and dinner? He said, Mommy, it's corn, tortilla, and bean. I said, how about lunch? Bean, tortilla, and rice. How about dinner? Rice, bean, and tortilla. Isn't the same thing? He said, he was really sick of that food. So at the first month, after the community services, they have a meeting at the hotel. And then there's a nearby Chinese restaurant. He went there to get a fried rice. And then he ate that fried rice that, you know, Chinese to go for 3 days. I said, but you don't have a refrigerator. How can you eat that rice for 3 days? He said, Mommy, that's better than I eat the rice, bean, and tortilla every day. So he came back. I said, hey, what do you want? What do you want to eat? When we picking up at the airport, he said, Mommy, I want the cashew chicken. And I went to Cafe Taipei, ordered cashew chicken. He came back. This is all for me. And that's why he told me for the 2 months, he only have that 2 chicken to eat, you know, at the end of the community services. But he didn't take any. So this all chicken is all for me. And he came back house and went upstairs. This is my room. This is bigger than my whole family. Then he started to value, you know, the, you know, really what was given to him, you know, and won't take everything for granted starting that. And that I think that community service really turned a boy into a man. Yeah, and really, even I was heartbroken sending to that poor town without anything, and he came back with a lot of funky stuff in his feet, you know, because they didn't have a good shoes or the shoes was broken. Anyway, it was hard work for him, but he learned a lot. And after that, I didn't need to worry about him anymore. And then he grew his manhood, and he started to have a lot of good friends because he learned to give and to love. So even now, you know, he still have, you know, all his best friends are still from high school, but he has a college friend as well. But I think he learned a lot from the community services. So, and even they are very poor. They use the cotton string to make some kind of necklace or the bracelet or to make the purse, you know. Little purse, he still have that up to date. Even that, you know, you cannot really use that for anything. But he wore that throughout his high school. He has that colorful string, you know, it's just a cotton string, but it's red or green. And that necklace, because it's made by the host family's children. Mm. And so he kind of hugged them and cried before he left. Mm. Yeah. I think community services overall is really good. It is, you know, not only for us, we contribute at a different level and different things. So I asked my son, say, you know, never quit your community services. You know, you contribute on different part to the community, and that make the whole community really loving, you know, and good.
That's it from us. Thank you for sharing.
Well, thank you very much.